Hey guys, I am Venkat and this is part 23 of Web Development with Blazor video series. In this video, we'll discuss how to create and use a custom validation attribute in Blazor. For most use cases, Blazor has several built-in attributes for model validation. We discuss some of these attributes in part 22 of this video series. If you have a complex validation requirement that you cannot implement using the built-in attributes, you can create a custom validation attribute and reuse it in your project or even in multiple projects if you create it in a separate class library project. At the moment, in our employee class, we already have email property decorated with email address attribute. So if we try to edit an employee row and provide an email address which is not valid, we get validation error as expected. Now, here is our new business requirement. We only want to allow prajimtech.com as the email address domain. If any other domain is provided, maybe something like gmail.com, we want to display a validation error. Only prajimtech.com is allowed as the email domain. There are several ways to implement this. For example, we can use a regular expression validator to very easily implement this, but let's create a custom validator. In Blazor, to create a custom validator, we create a class that derives from the built-in validation attribute abstract class. So in our shared project in the utilities folder, let's add a new class file. To keep it meaningful, let's name our class file allowed email domain attribute. Let's make the class public. And remember, to create a custom validation attribute, we create a class that derives from the built-in validation attribute class. This class is present in system.componentModel.dataAnnotations namespace, so let's bring that in. All we need to do inside this class is override isValid method. Notice the moment we type override and then press the spacebar, we see all the methods that we can override. The method that we want to override is this method, which takes two parameters, value and validation context. We don't need this line, base.isValid. First, let's check if value is null or value.toString dot length equals zero. Basically, we are checking if an empty string is provided. If a value for email address is not provided, notice the return type of this isValid method, validation result. So let's return a new instance of validation result class. And to this class, we can pass the error message that we want to display. In this case, a value for email address is not provided. So let's display this message, email address is required. Else, a value for email address is provided. So let's check in the provided value if we have an at character. So value.toString.indexOf, and we want to find the index of at character. If that is equal to -1, that means we can't find at character in the provided email address. Again, in this case also, we want to return an instance of validation result object. Because if a provided email address does not contain at character, it's an invalid email address. So let's change the message to invalid email address. Now, if this first condition is not true, that means a value for email address is provided. And if the second condition is not true, in the provided email address, we have at character. So our next step is to split the string based on that at character. For that, let's create a variable of type string array, and let's call the variable strings. Convert the value to string, and then let's use string split method. And we want to split based on at character. Now, let's say the provided email address is this, venkat@prajimtech.com. When we split the string based on this at character in the strings array variable, we'll have two strings. The first string will contain the value Venkat and the second string will contain prajimtech.com. And remember, in C#, strings are zero index based. So in strings of zero, we'll have Venkat, and in strings of one, we'll have prajimtech.com. So basically, we want to check if strings of one value is prajimtech.com. So let's use an if condition, strings of one And to do a case insensitive check, let's convert the value to lowercase and then do the comparison to presumetech.com. If the domain name is presumetech.com, then our validation has succeeded. So let's return validation result dot success. Else, provided email domain is other than presumetech.com. So let's again return a new instance of validation result object, but this time the error message is going to be email domain must be presumetech.com. Our obvious next step is to use this custom validation attribute. We use a custom validation attribute just like any other built-in validation attribute. So in our employee class, let's decorate this email property with our custom validation attribute. Remember, our custom validation attribute is allowed email domain attribute. This class is present in a different namespace, blazorproject.shared.utilities. So let's bring the namespace in. Now, here is another interesting tip. When using an attribute, the attribute part of the name is optional. Notice these other built-in attributes, we don't have the suffix attribute in their name. We can do the same even with our custom attribute. So basically, the attribute part is optional. So we can either use allowed email domain attribute, the full name, or just allowed email domain attribute. It works exactly the same way. Notice now, when we provide an email address where the domain is not presumetech.com, we get the validation error. If we provide presumetech.com, the validation error disappears and we can even update data. At the moment, the way we have implemented this custom validation attribute, it's not reusable with other domains. We can only use it with presumetech.com. And the reason for that is we have hard-coded the email domain name within the validator. And we don't want to do that. We want to be able to use this custom validation attribute with any email domain, dell.com, microsoft.com, presumetech.com, etc. So basically, we want to be able to do something like this. We want to be able to pass the email domain that we want to validate against as a parameter to our validation attribute, something like this. For example, dell.com. Achieving this is very easy. All we have to do is in our custom validator class, we include a constructor. So let's use the CTOR code snippet for this. To the constructor, we want to pass a parameter. The parameter type is string, and let's call the parameter allowed domain. And then notice when I press control period, we get two options. We want to create a property, so let's select this first option. And then if we scroll down a bit, in the if condition here, instead of checking against this hard-coded value, we can use this property allowed domain. Let's convert the value that we have in this property also to a lowercase and then compare. Now, if we try to use any other domain other than dell.com, actually, let's use dell.com. Notice we don't have any validation error. If we use any other domain, for example, gmail.com, we have the validation error. But look at the error message. It still says email domain must be presumetech.com. And that's because we still have that domain name hard-coded in the error message that we are returning here. So basically, we want to be able to return whatever value we have in allowed domain property. And to be able to pass a property name into the string, let's use dollar in front of the string. Now, if we use a domain other than dell.com, we get the correct validation error. Email domain must be dell.com because to our validation attribute, we are passing the domain name as dell.com. Let's change it to presumetech.com. Now, if we provide a domain other than presumetech.com, notice in the validation error message, we have the allowed domain, in this case, presumetech.com. As expected. Now, here's what I want to be able to do. Let's say I don't like this validation error message, and I want to be able to pass the validation error message that I want to display to this attribute by using error message property. I want the error message to be something simple like this, invalid domain. If you're wondering where is this error message property coming from, well, you can see that from the IntelliSense here. It is coming from the built-in validation attribute class. And we know our custom validation attribute class In this case, allowed email domain class derives from the built-in validation attribute class. So through inheritance, this error message property is available for our custom validation attribute class. And we have provided an error message that we want to be displayed. But let's see if this property value will be used. As usual, if we provide domain other than presumetech.com, we get the validation error as expected. But notice our validation attribute is not using the error message that we have provided using this error message property. And that's because within our custom validation attribute class, this is the error message that we are always returning. Email domain must be whatever value we have in allowed domain property. Now, here's what we want to be able to do. If there is a value in this error message property, then we want to use this property. Otherwise, we want to fall back to this error message, and it's very easy to implement. Remember, within our custom validation attribute class, we have access to the base class error message property, and we can access that using this dot error message and then double question mark. So what we are using here is C# null coalescing operator. Basically, we are telling if there is a value in this property, use it. Otherwise, fall back to this error message. Notice now we see the error message that we have provided using error message property. If we don't include this property at all, now notice we fall back to the validation error message that we have in our custom validation attribute class. That's it in this video. Thank you for listening.